I'm Adam Burns and welcome to Meet the Boss TV. This week, Novi, Michigan, to get some lessons on leadership from a man who really understands energy, or at least I hope so, Joe Welch, President and CEO for ITC Holdings. Joseph L. Welch started his energy career with Detroit Edison in 1971, but it really sparked to life in 2003 when he and 38 brave souls founded ITC Holdings, currently the Midwest's leading electric transmission company. He led ITC to IPO just 15 months after startup and proudly rang the New York Stock Exchange bell when the company went public in 2005. In 2007, he was named one of the US Entrepreneurs of the Year, and in 2008, opened the brand new headquarters building you see behind me, which can currently accommodate up to 600 staff. Clearly, Joe's story is nowhere near at an end, but I wanted to go back to the beginning, at least of the ITC portion of his career, to find out what was his founding vision.
Well, my original strategy was survival, but, candidly, we, myself and a group of people, felt that transmission was truly a strategic link to the country moving forward towards energy independence. We knew that we needed to build an independent system to do that, and so myself and about 38 other people who had the courage to leave their jobs and come with me, we started down that path.
And you say these people were brave enough to leave their jobs and come with you, but the crucial thing is, of course, they came with you. How did you get them to coalesce around your vision?
I've asked that question a thousand times. I actually believe that a lot of people that I had worked with shared the vision that, candidly, the utility system that we have in the United States is broken. That it was one of the greatest achievements of the 20th century. I believe it to be the greatest Achilles heel of the 21st century. That the system that we grew, the electrification of the United States, was not going to allow us to move to the next level where we have to be, because today we have approximately 500 owners of the transmission grid. Think about if you had 500 owners of the interstate highway system. How would you ever get it coordinated? How would you ever build the interstate highway system that you have? And we all felt that we could make a difference. And for myself and the other people, it just came at a time when I think the frustration of our thoughts were starting to boil over. And so we just said, let's give it a shot.
So we say you started with 38 people. Mm-hmm. How many of those 38 still with you?
I haven't counted, but I guess around 30. The thing is that, as I told people in the very beginning, a lot of them looked like me, a little bit on the gray and balding side. The ladies, of course, they weren't graying. But the fact is that, some people who were ready to step across the aisle were probably in a position where they could do it without a lot of downside. Some of those people have retired, and some that haven't are planning to. The younger people, from start to finish, are all here. They are part of a dynamic organization, and I think they're loving life every day. Probably a little frustrated, wish it was a little easier because it is a tough business, but they're all here.
Joe was named one of Ernst & Young's U.S. Entrepreneurs of the Year in 2007. I asked him what this award meant so early in ITC's development and if it impacted at all on his leadership style.
Not at all. That award or any other award that you get, doesn't really reflect on me. But the one thing that I did do is I made sure that everybody that was here day one had the opportunity to be at the awards ceremony. I told them whether we won or lost, we were all going to be there. And so we did that, and they had a little celebration back here also for everybody, just because it was ours.
Was that a late night?
I can't talk about
this. No, of course not. I wouldn't push you. Your role particularly, being the leader of the firm, you say setting terms, setting vision, must have changed since the start, because obviously you start with 38 employees, you've now got a combination here for 600, ITC clearly a very successful thing. How has that changed?
Well, there's a lot of things, and they're little things, and not all of them do I like. I probably, as a person, am better suited to running a small company than a big company, and we got to be a big company. I can tell you when we started business, I used to go around and say, good morning to everybody. Very few mornings did I miss it. I used to know everybody when they walked down the hall. I knew their kids. I knew who they were. I knew where they were at in their life, you know, married, divorced, having babies, grandchildren, all those things. Today I see a lot of people, and you know, it's hard for me to remember all of their names. We hire them pretty quickly. The people out in the field, I just don't have the close proximity with. I used to be, you know, a part of a lot of things that are going on. The role in the company has changed, and the other thing is that it's a lot easier when you're under the radar. But today, people know who you are, and so. You have to be very careful about everything that you do. You know, you're literally on a stage 724, and it's probably not as much fun.
Joe believes that ITC's success is bigger than his own personal efforts. It's a direct reflection of his staff's hard work and quality. So what are his lessons for team leaders?
For the most part, I have a young management team, and my young management team is my constant preach is you have to be a team, that, you know, we have to prepare this company for the inevitable that, you know, I'm not going to be here to eternity, that I've had them and had the conversation with you all now, or your job is to run the company. And then we'll meet back here in the locker room and we'll discuss how it's going. Some days it's very blunt, some days it's going very well. But, you know, we have to have those meetings, and I have to be a good enough leader to let them have the latitude that they need to make mistakes and be patient that we're going to get to the place where we want to be. I have to stay focused on what I need to do for the office that I'm in. When we come into the locker room, as I would call it, you park your ego in the garage. So if you have some alter ego, you know, take it someplace else, because in here we've got to get down to being, run this company. This isn't about status, stature, or anything else. This is about getting the right things done for this company.
So what have been the key moments then for you in the evolution, really, of your leadership style?
Well, I think the first thing was when I worked at another company, I was told that I didn't have any leadership capability. That was a key moment in my life. That's when you know your career there isn't going anywhere. Other defining moments is clearly, you know, when you look at just things being listed on the New York Stock Exchange. It's a true codification that your business is a real business. To see the performance of the company when we stack it up against the peers. In the business, and again to see us being always stacked up in the upper tier on all of our performances. And when you look over the whole time frame that we have been listed on the New York Stock Exchange, we've had great performance. Now, you know, in defense of everyone else, you know, it's easier to start when you're little and double your size. It's hard to double your size when you're big. And that, you know, that'll be the next test. You know, how do we grow? Because we're not big, but not little anymore either. We've kind of crossed into that mid-cap range where, you know, it's going to be a defining moment.
You talked about locker rooms earlier and the fact that you were kind of stepping back to be a good coach. Did you have a mentor yourself?
I didn't have a mentor per se. I had someone who I just observed a lot and worked for that I thought that he was truly a great leader. He had a lot of things in his style that probably being an engineer that I could emulate because he was an engineer, but he was a person that really felt that the customer should be first, felt that, you know, a quality speaks for itself. You don't have to go out and tout it. He did not want to have so much of the awards for something that wasn't real. He was really more interested in having the real thing and then trying to let it come. And that he was a person who would let you make a mistake and then tell you the mistake you made. He'd oftentimes tell me, you know, I wouldn't do that, but I think you should go do it to find out what the outcome's going to be.
Well, there's an argument, and they say that, you know, we really do learn better, sadly, from sticking our fingers in the socket.
Well, and exactly. And the fact is that if it's not going to kill someone, and it's not going to, you know, cost shareholders a lot of money, then I think we should do it. because you know, I'm not always right either. And you know, the telling moment in a sporting event is when the player's on the floor in crunch time. Does he look to the bench to call the play, or does he know what to do? And the winners are the ones that know what to do, and the losers are the ones that are looking to the bench. And the worst thing that I could have happen to me is when crunch time comes, everybody looks to me for the answer. I may not even have the right answer.
Do you think then that transition from being the small company to being the large company is the transition from being a player on the field to being on the bench for you personally?
Yes, it is. I mean, you know, there's books written about, you know, companies and where they started in their evolutionary chain and where they're going. And we've gone through two steps of what's in the book on the evolutionary chain. And the question you have to challenge yourself with after I kind of understood some of it is, do I have enough management skills to go to the next level myself? And do I have the management team that can go to the next level? Because if you look at, let's look at great companies, General Motors. Let's look at Sears and Roebuck when it was Sears and Roebuck. Look at Montgomery Ward. We don't even know about them anymore. And then look at Walmart, how they started to change and how they did a different type of focus. And what you found out is that the management styles in each company were different. And the management style that was great for a company like Sears, again, turned out to be their Achilles heel. We face that same thing today. I don't think there's a job in this company that people haven't been asked to change themselves. A lot of people resist and say, oh, no. We did it this way last year. Well, last year was last year, you know, and I think we have to constantly look to reinvent ourselves to make sure that we're going to stay contemporaneous to what we need to get done. Otherwise, stagnation and that evolutionary chain as you go up becoming a different company will stop.
And how about the people that are here, the staff that you've got now? You've got a very clear goal. How are you keeping them motivated, enthused, and engaged despite these sort of tough times?
Through intimidation. No. The most important thing, my true belief, is that people understand where it is we're going. And I've made a lot of effort starting at the end of last year and carrying into this year, and we'll carry well into this year, to make sure that everybody here understands where we're going, what role I play. You don't have to worry about your job. In other words, this place is not overstaffed. I've always had the vision that we would be a few people short rather than a few people long. I've worked at other places where they were overstaffed, and that's the most it's the most debilitating thing you can watch, because people start worrying about their job more than worrying about doing their job, because they know they're not needed. We have financial incentives in place. My bonus goals, the ones that I get my bonus on, is exactly the same one as my secretary's bonuses. In other words, from the top to the bottom in here, we all are on the same bonus plan. Our people in the field who are climbing the towers, their bonus plan is exactly ours. When there's a safety incident, my bonus is hit just like everyone else's, even if it wasn't mine doing, didn't come out of my office. And it's important that we all look at each other to help each other in this company, play our position going back to the team. And I think everybody stays pretty motivated on that. It's pretty exhilarating, actually, to be successful. Everybody likes winning the championship. How many people like working to win the championship? And when you know that you're meaningful to the count, that you're meaningful to the end product, and that the end product from the boss on down is the same for our bonus, then I think everybody gets on the page.
When that guy told you that you didn't have any leadership ability, did you know he was wrong?
Yeah. Yeah. I didn't have any leadership ability in his eyes, because I wasn't like him. When I thought that this was a noble business, I intended to keep it there. And that leadership ability was to make sure that, from their vision, that we would never make a change to what it was today. So if I wanted to lead in his direction, then I wasn't going to be a person that I am. And so I just thought that, well, I can lead. It's just not where you want me to go.
So thank you very much indeed. Yeah,
thank you.
For more fantastic interviews directly related to your business, be sure to explore Meet the Boss TV.